Do you remember complex numbers the first time they were taught to you? Did you really utterly question your aptitude towards math? Because I did. Because I was so confused about why on earth are we learning about this? Why? Who made this?
Take a number, multiply that number by itself, you will get the square of that number. That number can never be negative. Even if you square a negative number, you will get a positive number. So a square can never be negative. The opposite operation is called a square root. Square root of 4 is 2. Square root of 9 is 3. But square root of minus 9 does not make any sense because you cannot multiply any number by itself to get minus. Minus 3 times minus 3 is 9. It's not minus 9. So mathematicians created a number called I equal to under root of minus 1. These numbers are called imaginary numbers, bad name. And the combination of real and imaginary numbers is called a complex number. It's a complex of real part and imaginary part.
How can you think of something like that in the hopes that it'll be useful? Imaginary numbers? What is that? And I think the reason they were confusing was not because they are difficult to understand. It's only confusing because we are not told about the motivation behind mathematics and mathematicians creating new maths. And I truly believe if you understand the motivation behind why mathematicians did what they did, you would understand more about it. It would make more sense. It would really make more sense. And this is the motivation behind it. See, maths, you must understand the first thing about maths is that it is more invented and less discovered. It's an invention of rules, and then you have to build on those rules with logic, and you discover patterns and you discover new things and you discover structures within the perimeters of those rules. As a student, if you are told, okay, yeah, it does not make any sense, that's fine. Let's just see what happens if we just create a new imaginary number called I, which when multiplied by itself gives us minus 1. That's a pure invention of new mathematics. And if you are told that as a student, it would make more sense. It's like making a new game. Who doesn't understand that? God, those days, those moments, those times, had someone just told me this fact, you reach the end of your understanding and you say, all right, let's just open this door and see what's on the other side. And now this is where things get absolutely mind-boggling. How can our mathematics come close to talking about the real world and explaining the real world? Complex numbers were created in 1500s. Since then, they have been used in a lot of places. And one really specific and really interesting and fascinating place they are used in is called the Schrödinger's wave equation, which tells us how the universe will evolve if we know the initial conditions. Don't worry about the rest of the equation. All I'm interested in here in this video is this part, this I. This I was created in 1500s. How is that game that was created by mathematicians who were bored by just normal numbers and wanted to expand and play around with something? Okay, under root of minus 1 does not make any sense. Let's define it as something. Let's define it as I imaginary. We just imagine that there is something imaginary over there. Now that I is used in the most fundamental equation of quantum mechanics, that Schrödinger's wave equation. How does that make any sense? How did we get so lucky? How did we get so lucky as human beings that we have just the right tools created hundreds and hundreds of years before they are ever going to be used? How can you even reason? Why is that happening? how is our minds that was created by the evolutionary process of survival, our intuition was developed to survive, that intuition created mathematics, just something to play around with, something to do our commerce with, something to understand what the size of my farm is going to be. If I cut off this triangular part portion from it, how much do you need to pay me to give that piece of land to you? All those tools that we created over thousands of years, how is it even possible that those tools are able to explain the most fundamental things in the universe? How?
So in 1960, Nobel Prize winning physicist Eugene Wigner wrote this paper on exactly this conundrum.
So what is the conclusion of this paper? What does it say? What did Eugene Wigner, what does he think about this magical property of mathematics? You can go either ways. You can say that mathematics is the language of physics. Mathematics is the language of nature. That's what Max Tegmark says, that in his book, Our Mathematical Universe, he says that the whole universe is a mathematical object, and no wonder mathematics works so nicely, and because the whole thing is made of, from top down, bottom up, it's all mathematics, it's all mathematical models. Eugene Wigner concluded something else. He said, it might be the fact that we are not even looking at those theories that don't fit this nice little box. Our sciences and our mathematics has had a history of being swayed by elegance and simplicity. If a theory feels elegant and simple, it's bound to be right. That's the behavior human beings have shown as scientists. Eugene Wigner says that we are missing out on all those ugly and complex theories because we do not look for them. If we look for something, we have a preconceived notion of what the solution might be, we cannot find other types of solutions. We cannot find, our theories might be constrained. Our solutions might just be constrained by our need for simplicity and elegance. Physical theories have always been about reductionism, which means how can we explain a phenomenon by reducing that into the elementary particles or the forces acting on the most elementary particles. But not all things can be explained like that. David Deutsch, in his book called The Fabric of Reality, gives a very interesting example of when this thing fails, when reductionism just fails. How do you explain, he says, how a copper atom reached from under the ground up to the Statue of Liberty, up to the nose of Statue of Liberty? That cannot be explained by the forces acting on particles and the initial conditions of the universe. The explanation of why that happened lies in emergent phenomenon of biology, culture, psychology, and politics. We have been looking at physical theories at that level. Maybe we should consider emergent theories as fundamental theories. If you want to know more about this, you should read this paper. It does not have any equations. It's freely available online, and it's just fascinating. If you like such videos, help the channel grow by liking and subscribing, and follow us on Instagram. This is our handle. We share work in progress videos for each video, and you can look them up in our highlights, story highlights. See you next time.